Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mason-Dixon, Crucible of the Nation, by Edward G. Gray, narrated by Walter Dixon. What satire on government can equal the severity of censure conveyed in the world politic, which now for ages has signified cunning, intimating that the state is a trick? Ralph Waldo Emerson, Politics. Note on terms. Until the latter half of the 20th century, the Mason-Dixon line was generally referred to as Mason and Dixon's line. In its earliest 18th century usages, that name referred to the portion of the boundaries between Maryland, Delaware, and Pennsylvania, surveyed by the English astronomers Charles Mason and Jeremiah Dixon. Beginning with the debate over Missouri's admission to the Union in 1819 and 1820, politicians, such as Virginia Congressman John Randolph, used Mason and Dixon's line in a more familiar metaphoric sense to refer to the national divide between free and slave states. On 19th century usages of Mason and Dixon's line, see Richard H. Thornton, An American Glossary, being an attempt to illustrate certain Americanisms upon historical principles. Except when quoting historical sources or referring directly to Mason and Dixon's survey in Chapter 6, I use the modern Mason-Dixon line, or just the line. Prologue. Near the end of 1764, the first full year of their great American surveying expedition, Charles Mason, Jeremiah Dixon, and their party briefly camped on the banks of the Nanticoke River. The surveyors spent a few days at the site, awaiting supplies from Philadelphia. Mason used the time to explore his surroundings. What he discovered in the heart of the peninsula separating the Delaware and Chesapeake Bays was spectacular natural beauty. The flora of the nearby Pocomoke Swamp took Mason's breath away. "There is," he observed, "the greatest quantity of timber I ever saw." And that timber was not merely abundant, it was also majestic. Giant oaks, beeches, poplars, hickories, hollies, and bald cypresses. Above them all towered the lofty cedar, its trunk shooting skyward, a colossal wooden vessel whose green conical top seems to reach the clouds. During the preceding 3 months, the surveying party had slowly made its way south, plotting the 82-mile meridian line that would separate Maryland from the lower counties, also known as the Delaware Colony. The party had traversed a landscape bearing the marks of centuries of human habitation. Much of what had once been heavily forested coastal plain and wetlands was now cleared and drained, first by native farmers and dugout canoe makers, and later by English tobacco planters and their servants and slaves. By the time Mason and Dixon's party traversed the peninsula, many of those farms had begun abandoning tobacco for grain, but the effects of a century of intensive tobacco farming were plain. Only at the Pocomoke Swamp, a remnant of primordial wetlands that once enveloped the peninsula's southern reaches, did Mason glimpse American nature's sublime majesty. In the coming century, that remnant would shrink further, drained by farmers and cleared by loggers. From spring 1765 to late fall 1767, Mason and Dixon plotted the west line separating Maryland and Pennsylvania and carrying the surveyors deep into the North American woodlands. Few Englishmen would have a better grasp of the stunning topographical range of eastern North America. From the coastal plain of the Delmarva Peninsula, as the entire eastern shore peninsula would later come to be known, the surveyors passed into the rolling northern Piedmont of Cecil County in Maryland and Chester and Lancaster counties in Pennsylvania. What they saw of the human-made landscape differed from eastern shore Maryland. In place of small tobacco and grain plantations, worked by white farmers, their servants, and African-American slaves, the region was a patchwork of forests and the family farms of English, Scots-Irish, and German migrants. As the surveyors moved west, through the fertile Piedmont to the North American continent's aged eastern mountains, they crossed the broad, shallow Susquehanna River. By the end of September 1765, they had hauled their party up and down South Mountain, the northernmost of the Blue Ridge Mountains. On South Mountain's western face, they found a brief reprieve in the Great Cumberland Valley, known further south as the Shenandoah Valley, and separating the eastern Blue Ridge from the Appalachian Plateau, that vast assemblage of mountains, valleys, and waterways through which runs North America's eastern continental divide. The further inland the surveyors traveled, the smaller and more widely dispersed the farms. Longer, colder winters meant shorter growing seasons and more time devoted to surviving the fallow months. Dense, deciduous forests still abounded, requiring the surveyors to employ teams of axemen to cut lengthy channels through the woods. As the surveying party traversed the hills and valleys between South Mountain and the foothills of the Allegheny Ridge, they used wagon roads and trails originally cleared by native hunters and traders. But few of these paralleled the line for long. The Forbes Road, named for British General John Forbes, traveled well north of the west line. Braddock's Road, beginning deep in the Shenandoah Valley and named for Edward Braddock, another British general, ran parallel to the line for a little over 50 miles, between Fort Cumberland in western Maryland and the site of the first battle of the French and Indian War, Fort Necessity, just over the line in Pennsylvania. Mason and Dixon ultimately cut their own path. Nothing in either the human-made or natural contours of the region suggested a straight line, let alone a straight east-west line. As autumn deepened, the surveyors returned east. The following spring, they would ascend the Appalachian Mountains and spend the summer hacking their way through mountainous terrain to the survey's endpoint, a little over 10 miles outside present-day Morgantown, West Virginia. The west line covered 230 miles from the northeastern corner of Maryland, roughly the distance between Philadelphia and Providence, Rhode Island, or between Baltimore and the eventual location of Wheeling, West Virginia. About half that journey was through mountains. The Appalachian Plateau sits across the line at an oblique southwest to northeast angle, a giant boomerang-shaped range of mountains and valleys about 150 miles wide and rising to a height of over 3,200 feet above sea level. Many of its dense coniferous forests more akin to the boreal forests of Canada than those of the Cumberland Valley or the Piedmont. The rivers and streams flowing down from the mountains also cross the line at oblique angles. On the eastern face, they flow in a mostly southeasterly direction, dozens of them, toward the meandering Potomac River. Further east, they drain into branches of the Susquehanna River before it disgorges into the Chesapeake Bay. For centuries before the arrival of Europeans, and for about a century after, the waterways and mountains bisecting the Mason-Dixon line had dictated the movement of people and goods. Native peoples, traveling the mid-Atlantic river systems in swift and lightweight birch bark canoes, moved produce to and from coastal communities. Copper, animal skins, and furs traveled south and east. Wampum, stone pots, tobacco pipes, and maize traveled north and west. European-made goods began arriving in the 16th century. Glass beads, leather belts, straps, and shoes, metal tools, textiles, and firearms. These too traveled far inland, carried by native traders in search of ever scarcer beaver pelts. Indigenous travelers never limited their movement to water routes. They carved hundreds of paths through the eastern woodlands, many following creeks and rivers, but many also moving inland, across the Piedmont to the high country. With European settlement, these arteries of commerce and transit remained in use, traversed by native and European fur traders, military personnel, and migrants, the last in search of fertile farmlands, often overgrown with dense forest, long abandoned by native agriculturalists. In the years Mason and Dixon traveled through these colonial borderlands, fewer descendants of the region's original native inhabitants remained. The Susquehannocks had once controlled most of the southern Susquehanna River Valley. Their ancestors had arrived from the north, a distant band of Iroquoian peoples drawn to the region's rich woodlands. An early 17th century account, written by the English explorer Captain John Smith, referred to these people as Susquehannos, a name Smith learned from an Eastern Algonquin-speaking interpreter. To Dutch and Swedish colonists, these inland Indians would come to be known as Minquas, another term of Eastern Algonquin origins. What they called themselves is unknown, but historians and archaeologists have retained a version of the name Captain Smith used, mostly because the broad river near their villages came to bear a version of that name as well. Smith and his party are the first Europeans known to have made contact with the Susquehannocks, although in fact it was the Susquehannocks who made contact with the Englishmen, who whose barge had stalled near the mouth of the Susquehanna River. The river, originating in two branches, a northern one flowing out of the mountains of what is now southeastern New York State, and a western one flowing down from the Pennsylvania mountains, had left too much sediment and too many rocky shoals near its mouth to afford passage for the English watercraft. But Susquehannock envoys readily paddled their canoes downriver to meet the visitors. Smith described the Susquehannocks as giants, whose speech sounded as a voice in a vault, and who came dressed in bear and wolf skins. These striking men brought gifts of bows, arrows, wampum beads, swords, and tobacco pipes, clearly prepared to forge commercial relations with this latest party of foreigners to visit their homeland. Smith learned that homeland was extensive and vibrant. The Susquehannocks lived in several palisaded villages, all defended by several hundred able-bodied warriors. Smith's account leaves little doubt that the Susquehannocks were a formidable presence, but it comes nowhere near capturing the full scope of Susquehannock military and economic power. Years of playing Eastern Indian nations and their European trading partners against one another allowed the Susquehannocks to dominate trade across the northern Chesapeake and lower mid-Atlantic. Through their connections to the Iroquois and Wyandots, commonly known as the Hurons, the Susquehannocks triumphed in the great race to harvest beaver pelts from the forests of inland North America. Susquehannock successes in the fur trade would also account for the decline of Susquehannock power. Disease and war, products of the contest for inland commercial primacy, took their toll, and by the end of the 17th century, there would be little left of the vibrant lower Susquehanna Indian villages. Some Susquehannocks would remain, but even they had mostly fled by the time Mason and Dixon first traversed the region. Just a few years earlier, Indians living near the site of the original Susquehannock villages had been nearly wiped out by a group of murderous Pennsylvania vigilantes known as the Paxton Boys. To the east, the Algonquin-speaking Lenape people had built thriving towns with a population roughly comparable to their Susquehannock neighbors, probably a few thousand. The Lenape lived along the lower Delaware River, their influence reaching south, down the shore of the Delaware Bay. The Lenape were also traders, but like most Eastern Native societies, they engaged in a variety of sustenance practices. They grew maize, they hunted deer, turkeys, bears, and other game, and they harvested oysters, clams, and fish from nearby rivers and coastal waters. To the English, the Lenape, along with all the other Algonquin peoples living near the Delaware River, were known simply as Delawares. That the English named the Delaware River and the native peoples living near it for a governor of the Virginia colony, Thomas West, 3rd Baron Delaware, known for his brutal treatment of native peoples, was an irony lost on most. Mason and Dixon made no mention of the Lenape. After the onslaught of European settlement, enabled by fraudulent land claims and epidemics, most descendants of the 17th century Lenape had migrated north, settling in the upper Susquehanna River Valley. Others traveled west, and by the time Mason and Dixon traversed Lenape country, these Delawares were living in villages along the Ohio River and its tributaries. In the half-century following Mason and Dixon's survey, the mountainous western portion of the line would remain a place of sparse Euro-American settlement. The area to the east, across the Cumberland Valley and the Piedmont Ridge, would emerge as one of the western world's most productive grain-producing regions. Grist mills would proliferate, and with those mills would come towns of dry goods merchants, artisans, and manufacturers. By the 1830s, new networks of roads, canals, and railroads would carry all this economic expansion across the Appalachian Mountains to the Monongahela and Ohio River valleys. By the middle of the 19th century, those areas bore the marks of industrialized agriculture. The woodlands Mason and Dixon traversed had been largely consumed, cleared for farmlands or their timber burned as fuel to heat homes and feed iron furnaces and steam engines. Defying nature's dictates, the Mason-Dixon line cut through eastern North America, its purpose to bring peace to a region racked by war. The line never brought peace. It brought war of another kind. Mason had acquired a vague sense of the violence preceding his arrival in America, but unlike the enlightened colonial proprietors who hired him, he had little hope that a mere line on the land would bring peace to the Maryland-Pennsylvania borderlands. Violence, it seemed, had infected those lands to their very depths, leaving their immigrant inhabitants callous and cruel. The Indians recently slaughtered near the old Susquehannock homelands, Mason learned, had always lived under the protection of the Pennsylvania government and had lands allotted for them a few miles from Lancaster by the late celebrated William Penn, Esquire, proprietor. They had fled to the Lancaster jail to save themselves. The keeper made the door fast, but it was broken open, and two men went in and executed the bloody scene, while about 50 of their party sat on horseback without, armed with guns, etc. The people of Lancaster never offered to oppose the murderers, despite the nearby presence of sympathetic British troops. This cruel indifference followed decades of internecine warfare. As early as 1736, a Pennsylvania official informed Mason, settlers sent by the proprietors of Maryland and Pennsylvania were at open war. The surveying party, it had become clear, traversed a battle zone as old as any in eastern North America. During a break from surveying activities, Mason traveled into Maryland to visit a giant cave used for church services. The cave's majesty impressed Mason in a way the great Pocomoke Swamp had not. Here was a sublime nature with a very different, darker connotation. What Mason experienced was a natural cathedral whose vaulted ceiling drew the eye downward toward some sort of mortal abyss, striking its visitants with a strong and melancholy reflection that such is the abodes of the dead, thy inevitable doom, O stranger, soon to be numbered as one of them. Introduction. This book tells the story of a geopolitical boundary. That boundary marked the jurisdictional and territorial limits of the colonies, which would become the states of Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. And it still bears the name of the two English astronomers, Charles Mason and Jeremiah Dixon, who worked between 1763 and 1767 to establish its definitive location. Nestled in pastoral suburbs and gently rolling mid-Atlantic farmlands, the original Mason-Dixon line and its innocuous stone markers, many first placed by Mason and Dixon, hardly suggest a boundary, let alone a border, once as fraught as some of the world's most contested international borders. As you pass east along I-95 from Maryland into Delaware, or south from Chambersburg along I-81 toward Hagerstown, there is barely a sense of border crossing at all. Signs bear the laconic welcome of state governors. Rest stops have a few extra displays of tourist brochures, or there is a state line liquor store. Little else marks one's transit across the line. And yet, through the feverish middle decades of the 19th century, the Mason-Dixon line, much like so many other territorial demarcations, became a locus of tension and conflict and a source of many of the very same kinds of anxieties and failed, futile policies that modern borders have produced in our own day. The most contentious such policies were those established under the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, a law designed to weaken northern states' powers to stop the kidnapping and rendition of runaway slaves by giving the federal government primary jurisdiction in fugitive slave cases. Individual states could no longer determine the terms by which Southerners reclaimed slave property. And with the federal government beholden to Southern slaveholding interests, the liberty of self-manumitted former slaves was in true legal jeopardy everywhere in the continental United States. As has happened in other border regions when distant authorities attempt to assert control, after 1850, the borderlands adjoining the Mason-Dixon line witnessed a surge of vigilantism and violence. In one notable instance, on September 11, 1851, the Maryland slave owner Edward Gorsuch and a group of slave catchers who had crossed into Pennsylvania entered the small border town of Christiana. They had come to retrieve a group of runaways and carry them back to a life of slavery. Gorsuch and his party were met by a large group of locals, outraged that one of their own, William Parker, an African-American farm worker and self-manumitted slave, had been targeted for harboring fugitives. In the ensuing melee, Gorsuch was killed and another member of his party seriously injured. Authorities referred to the incidents at Christiana as a riot, deserving of the American equivalent of the old English Riot Act, established in the early 18th century, and giving magistrates the right to disperse or punish threatening mobs. 141 alleged rioters were arrested, and 39 were charged with treason against the United States. Although the government's case fell apart, the crisis at Christiana marked a new chapter in the history of the line. Much like undocumented immigrants in our own day, African Americans north of the line lived with the mortal fear of a species of deportation. As the federal government increased police activity north of the line, enslaved African Americans to the south saw hopes for freedom within the United States dim as well. In response, a decades-old network of African Americans and white abolitionists, now known as the Underground Railroad, redoubled its efforts to take enslaved African Americans across the line and eventually to safety in Canada. In 1854, Maryland anti-slavery activist, lawyer, and historian John H.B. Latrobe, son of the celebrated neoclassical architect Benjamin Henry Latrobe, observed that the Mason-Dixon line was always expressive of the fact that the states of the Union were divided into slaveholding and non-slaveholding, into northern and southern, and that those who lived on opposite sides of the line of separation were antagonistic in opinion upon an all-engrossing question, whose solution had been supposed to threaten the integrity of the Republic. In Latrobe's mind, the survival of the world's most admired democratic republic would depend on whether it could alter what the Mason-Dixon line had become, a border between North and South, slave states and free states. The border had lost any real significance as a boundary between specific states. Men cared little, Latrobe explained, where it ran or what was its history or whether it was limited to Pennsylvania or extended, as has perhaps most generally been supposed, from the Atlantic to the Pacific. Now, it suggested the idea of a Negro slavery, and that alone was enough to give it importance and notoriety. Latrobe's assessment echoes through the historical record to the present day, but as he recognized, it represented only part of the line's story. As much a metaphor for a United States divided by the issue of slavery, the line was a geopolitical border whose origins far predated the 19th century fugitive slave crisis. Latrobe's insight frames my own interpretation of the line's history. America's age-old reputation as a nation whose history has been driven by the defiance of boundaries and borders rests on deep historical amnesia. From very early in its history, the United States has been defined by borders and boundaries and all the tangled political struggles they reflect. Because my story is mostly one of government and politics, its central characters are agents of governance. English colonial proprietors and their various court patrons, Native American diplomats and traders, colonial governors, justices of the peace, tax collectors, and other officials. These are the primary actors in the first two parts of the book. The second two shift emphasis. In 1780, the new Republic of Pennsylvania enacted the world's first statutory act for the gradual abolition of slavery. From this point, in addition to a boundary between American states, the line became a boundary between slave states and a free state. What the legal change meant for the borderlands adjoining the line, and how it transformed a boundary between colonies into something resembling a border between slave states and an anti-slavery state. That is the story of the book's second half. As much a story of age-old policy struggles and jurisdictional confusion, this part of the book is also the story of a captive labor system and a federal republic whose legal treatment of that system varied widely from state to state. At the center of that story are slavery's opponents, black and white Americans, whose efforts had a profound impact on the legal and political regimes that had long sustained the institution of chattel slavery. But their impact on the line itself, on the political and legal culture of the counties and towns adjoining the line, would be much more incremental. As I explain in Part 3, the gradual abolition of slavery had very little impact on the peoples of the Maryland-Pennsylvania borderlands. A far greater consequence was the movement of goods from the borderlands to markets, mostly in the young boom town of Baltimore. Only in the 1850s did the work of abolitionists and hundreds of African American fugitives from slavery take hold and transform the region adjoining the line into one divided over the institution of slavery. That division, covered in the book's concluding two chapters, produced unlikely political alignments that explain why the states of Maryland and Delaware became so-called border states, or slave states that never seceded from the Union. Among the challenges of structuring the story of the Mason-Dixon line has been a subject that lies at the center of my career, the American Revolution. This familiar series of events figures prominently in the line's story, but less as a profound historical rupture than as a period of political realignment. Realignment that afforded Pennsylvania's radical statutory enactment of gradual abolition. Beyond this act, and its limited reverberations in the slave states adjoining the line, the Revolution does not figure prominently. Of greater significance in the line's history are events that precede the Revolutionary War. For much of the 18th century, the borderlands adjoining what would become the line were among the most war-racked and violent areas in the British colonial world. The politics of war and security, far more than independence from Great Britain and the forging of America's Federal Republic, would reverberate through the region to the Civil War era. As I tell it, the story of the line is really a story of Americans and the relationship to government. That relationship was frequently a profoundly antagonistic one. But that antagonism, an 18th century variety, bore very little resemblance to the familiar modern hostility to the federal government. There is very little evidence that the peoples of the borderlands were animated by anything like an ideological or libertarian antagonism toward government. If anything, the opposite was the case. Insofar as they were unified by politics, it was a politics of disappointment and aggrievement. The white, property-owning men who dominated the region's electoral politics demanded, over and over, more government. For most of the 18th century, those demands centered on security, as settlers and homesteaders fought native peoples and rival colonizers for possession of land. In the latter decades of the 18th century and the early decades of the 19th, those demands centered on the closely aligned matters of internal improvements and tax relief. That the demands of borderlands voters rarely translated into coherent government policy was symptomatic of another perennial problem, the eastward emphasis of state politics. This was more so in Pennsylvania than in the other states adjoining the line. But as by far the largest of those states, Pennsylvania exerted a disproportionate influence over the politics and economy of the borderlands. As eastern Pennsylvanians and their financial supporters pushed for control of the produce of America's countryside, the farmers and producers of the borderlands lost. This perception, driven by the divisive commercial politics of the region, would draw together the commercial basin between the Susquehanna River and the Appalachian Mountains, from central Pennsylvania, south through Maryland, to the Potomac. This region, which I call Greater Baltimore, defined the politics of the borderlands. And those politics were, above all, a politics of sectional grievance. By the end of the 18th century, Greater Baltimore was also a place of relative ethnic and religious uniformity. Although Maryland and Delaware were slave states, relatively few slaves lived in the border counties of these states. Free African Americans lived along the line, but the vast majority of the borderlands population were descendants of German-speaking and Scots-Irish settlers. The latter point is crucial. The ethnic composition of the borderlands was a legacy of the ethnocidal slaughter that enveloped them during the middle decades of the 18th century. Among the consequences of all that violence and slaughter was the displacement of Native American communities, who had long controlled the borderlands and their abundant natural and human-made wealth. The story of the line is as much a story of the colonial assault on these native peoples as it is of the emergence of Greater Baltimore. Had it not been for the lengthy, systematic dispossession of Native nations, Mason and Dixon's work would never have been undertaken. And even then, the surveyor's work was directly shaped by remaining Native control of the borderlands. Envoys from the Iroquois League provided Mason and Dixon passage through Indian country, but refused them passage across an Iroquois warpath, stopping the survey 31 miles short of its planned endpoint. Listeners familiar with early American history might justifiably wonder about the appropriateness of asserting the term border with the Mason-Dixon line. In modern usage, borders usually mark the territorial limits of sovereign geopolitical entities. As part of an international order that has prevailed in the European world since the 17th century, such entities, the most persistent of which have been states and empires, are assumed to have ultimate legal jurisdiction over bounded territorial claims. In their more modern iterations, nation-states also tend to be coterminous with ethno-linguistic groupings, or at least they have sought to achieve contiguousness with such groupings. The entities separated by the line never possessed sovereign control over historically delineated territories, and their respective populations had nearly identical ethno-linguistic compositions. Moreover, far from possessing independent and distinct legal and political systems, they were subordinate provinces of a single federated empire, governed first by Great Britain and later by the United States. Listeners might also wonder how a border between colonies or American states could serve the primary function of territorial borders, at least as they have functioned since the 19th century rise of the industrialized nation-state. That function, enabled by the sovereign exercise of governing power, centers on the power to control the movement of people. For most of its history, the Mason-Dixon line had no effect whatsoever on the movement of people. No walls or fences have ever been associated with the line. Similarly, the legal significance of the line never included any capacity to dictate insider-outsider status. For white Americans, at least, one's legal status was similar on both sides of the line. Although one might be subject to the jurisdiction of colonies or states adjoining the line, wherever one stood, one was the subject of the King of Great Britain, or later, a citizen of the United States. The situation would be very different for Americans of African descent, but the distinction had less to do with the line itself than with the peculiar political economy of slavery. Insofar as movement back and forth across the line was at all regulated, it was regulated because the line corresponded with legal limits on a particular commercial activity, chattel slavery. The states of Maryland and Delaware permitted slavery, the state of Pennsylvania severely restricted it. Only because of this interstate legal distinction does the line become at all meaningful as a regulator of travel and migration, as a means of establishing national affiliation or citizenship, and in turn, regulating the movement of human beings. The line was not, in any modern sense, a border. If the line is considered in the context of other efforts to mark and limit territory from the 17th through the mid-19th centuries, the term becomes more appropriate. Early America was a largely border-free place. There were no routinely regulated and policed geopolitical borders anywhere in North America until the 20th century. Much like Europe before the Napoleonic Wars, the American continent was generally a place of vaguely defined jurisdictions, frontiers, and marchlands. A traveler, not constrained by subservient status as a pauper, servant, apprentice, felon, slave, or Native American, the last ostensibly restricted to native territories and trade routes by deeds and treaties, could move freely through the countryside, back and forth across territorial claims of different colonies, states, empires, and indigenous nations, oblivious to political geography. In times of war, identity papers or passports were often necessary, but these rarely contained declarations of citizenship or national allegiance. They were akin to letters of introduction, documents endorsed by government officials or other persons of note testifying to the good character and peaceful purpose of the traveler, and they were usually needed for passing through ground claimed in war rather than across anything like a static international border. In Europe, the experience would have been much the same until one approached a river crossing or city. Remnants of the age of siege warfare, medieval walls and gates persisted into the 18th and early 19th centuries. A traveler crossing the Rhine into France or approaching a city could thus expect to confront gates and sentries demanding justification for entry, or perhaps requiring customs payments. This security apparatus was about as close as the pre-modern world came to something like a modern international border. As the architectural critic Lewis Mumford observed, far more than a mere opening, the city gate offered the first greeting to the trader, the pilgrim, or the common wayfarer. It was at once a customs house, a passport office, and immigration control point, and a triumphal arch, its turrets and towers often vying with those of the cathedral or town hall. In overwhelmingly rural 18th century mainland British North America, Boston had its gate and New York its wall of Wall Street fame. But otherwise, there was very little of this kind of regulatory architecture. The sovereign limits of empires, cities, and states were rarely discernible. Insofar as pre-modern states and empires had territorial limits, they tended to be referred to as frontiers rather than borders. This was indicative of the fact that, much like the city-states and kingdoms they succeeded, pre-modern states and empires had neither the inclination nor the means to articulate and defend precise lineal boundaries. The result was a kind of sovereignty that made only the vaguest claims to territory, especially territory far from the geographic loci of power. In a seminal study of the boundary between France and Spain in the Pyrenees, Peter Solins writes that, through the 18th century, the French monarchy continued to envision its sovereignty in terms of its jurisdiction over subjects, not over a delineated territory, relying on the inherited notions of jurisdiction and dependency, instead of basing its administration on firmly delineated territorial circumscriptions. While zonal boundaries or frontiers were evident in the early modern Pyrenees and elsewhere in Europe, particularly in the plains and forests along Russia's western frontier, the vastness of the Americas and the limits of mapping technology meant that they were particularly abundant in the Western Hemisphere. Even when maps suggested otherwise, imperial borders in the Americas tended more toward the zonal than the lineal. In an assessment that could be applied to an early modern Euro-American boundary, historian J. H. Eliot notes that the straight line drawn on a map made the frontier of Brazil the most clear-cut frontier in all the Americas. But nobody in the 17th or early 18th century had any accurate idea of where, in practice, Portuguese territory ended and the Spanish viceroyalty of Peru began. This distinction between cartographic ideal and geopolitical reality was never more evident than in Britain's ill-fated 1763 attempt to partition its mainland North American claims. The so-called Proclamation Line of 1763 was the cartographic answer to Britain's attempt to separate its Euro-American subjects from native nations by somehow arresting the flood of colonists across the Appalachian Mountains into Indian territory. On maps, the Proclamation Line looks like any carefully mapped boundary line, a stark imposition along the Appalachian spine. On the ground, of course, the line was invisible. British military officials charged with policing the line threw up their hands in frustration as settlers flooded through the Ohio River Valley into Indian country. As a partition between native and European nations, the Proclamation Line was, like most such partitions, a near total failure. Within European imperial claims, particularly the mainland North American claims of Great Britain, lineal boundaries were far more common. But these were not, strictly speaking, borders, or at least they were never conceived of as territorial borders. They were instead much more akin to the kinds of fences, walls, and other spatial boundaries that separated private land claims or that separated private estates from commons. Only in their scope did the boundaries between Pennsylvania and Maryland, or North Carolina and Virginia, or New York and Connecticut differ, at least in a legal sense, from the boundaries that demarcated commons from a feudal manor, or that separated one manor from another. Both manorial boundaries and colonial boundaries marked the limits of land and title, licensed by royal authority to the various interests granted exclusionary rights to the crown's overseas possessions. Much as in Britain, where titled lords controlled manors and incorporated bodies controlled some municipalities, the colonies were held by lords, such as William Penn and Cecil Calvert, the second Lord Baltimore, and by private corporate entities, such as the Massachusetts Bay Company or the Lords Proprietors of Carolina. Insofar as these proprietary estates were bounded, they were bounded by cartographic decisions made by agents of the Crown on the basis of only fragmentary geographic data, and in the service of a domestic political agenda unrelated to the realities of colonial life. The results of this arbitrary and narrowly instrumental approach to boundary making are readily apparent in maps of the eastern United States. Colonial British America was largely a place of straight lines. In their Euclidean perfection, the boundaries separating the American colonies and most of their successor states betray a purpose that had very little at all to do with bounding sovereign territory. Colonial boundaries reflected neither military conquest nor natural barriers to sovereignty, in the way that, say, the Pyrenees did for France and Spain. Instead, they reflected the arbitrary, top-down division of a monarchical domain. These boundaries, usually established by the Lords of Trade, a committee of Charles II's Privy Council, and later by the Board of Trade, a royally appointed advisory board, reflect the very narrow mandate of the king's colonial agents: to reward a small number of loyal subjects with landed estates, something European monarchs had been doing with ever more elaborate pomp and ritual since the early Middle Ages. Early America may have been a place of boundaries, but it was not a place of borders. The boundary that would become the Mason-Dixon line was different. In comparison to the frontiers and boundaries that crisscrossed early America, it looked and acted very much like a modern territorial border. Although the boundary that became the Mason-Dixon line was much like the various colonial boundaries created by British government officials in the 17th and early 18th centuries, the boundary established by Charles Mason and Jeremiah Dixon had origins in military conflict and its associated fiscal demands, much as was the case with the boundaries of territorial nation-states. The French and Indian War brought new and onerous fiscal problems to the colony of Pennsylvania. Those problems were exacerbated by the fact that, without a clear border between Maryland and Pennsylvania, taxes, both direct, in the form of poll and property taxes, and indirect, in the form of militia and public service musters, ferry and turnpike fees, trade imposts, and excise taxes, became very difficult to levy. The fact that colonists living along the line often had no idea if they lived in Delaware, Maryland, or Pennsylvania also made it very difficult for courts to adjudicate civil disputes or enforce criminal law. Without functioning courts, these regions left colonial lawmakers with the convenient perception that the Mason-Dixon borderlands were unworthy of public expenditure, feeding a politics of aggrievement and alienation. As a geopolitical demarcation, in other words, the Mason-Dixon line may not have separated territorial nations, but its historical origins and problems of taxation and security were very much akin to the origins of international borders that did do this. Similarly, the colonies and states bounded by the Mason-Dixon line were never recognized as sovereign, independent members of an international community of sovereign and independent states. But this did not mean they were somehow the opposite of independent nation-states. They were not vassal states. Their internal affairs were never controlled by exogenous authorities. Not until the very end of the last period covered here, the American Civil War, did either the British Empire or the United States aspire to achieve that kind of authority over its member provinces. If anything, the constitutional apparatuses underpinning both the British Empire and the new American Republic contained an array of mechanisms for the devolution of central, imperial-style authority. Britain's American colonies possessed legally constituted governing institutions with powers associated with the modern state. They could tax, they could wage war, and they could treat and trade with certain quasi-foreign nations, the last reflective of the fact that neither Great Britain nor the United States was ever entirely consistent in their relations with autonomous Native American nations. The colonies did all of these things. For this reason, historian Patrick Spiro has referred to colonial Pennsylvania as a colony state. The designation could as easily apply to all of Britain's mainland colonies. The revolution that transformed these colonies into confederated states began in part because the British government set out to reverse constitutional precedent. The constitutional order linking Great Britain to its mainland colonies was much more like a League of Nations than a Roman-style empire. The colonies had always been responsible for their internal affairs, which is precisely why so many saw the stamp tax as unconstitutional. It was a tax levied by Parliament on goods made within the colonies themselves. Of course, the colonies' assertion of constitutional autonomy gave way to a new push for an external imperial-like authority. That push culminated in a new federal constitutional power to levy taxes within formerly independent American states. The unraveling of the autonomy enjoyed by the former British colonies would nevertheless be a long and slow process. The authority to tax, for example, did not necessarily translate into effective tax policy. The Whiskey Rebellion, a 1794 Pennsylvania rebellion against a federal tax on distilled spirits, left little doubt about the political challenges of federal taxation. William Penn and Charles Calvert, the third Lord Baltimore, initially faced their boundary troubles in the late 17th century through diplomatic channels. The two colonial proprietors used emissaries, ambassadors, to begin negotiations, and they approached the problem of their disputed boundary as a diplomatic one, undertaken by two geopolitical entities relating to each other through the protocols and rituals of treaty making. During the 18th century, the proprietors' descendants would redefine the dispute as one over private property and would seek redress through the king's courts. Once these proprietary colonies became states and their boundary conflicts were taken up by the respective governments of the new states, an old 17th century pattern returned. The Maryland-Pennsylvania boundary dispute left the civil courts and returned to the provincial capitals. Diplomatic delegations, deputized by governors of the adjoining states, would again be called on to resolve the boundary question. The point here is that although the boundary line separating Maryland, Delaware, and Pennsylvania was not, strictly speaking, an international border, for much of its history, those charged with administering the line acted as if, in fact, it was. The colonies separated by the line defy easy historical classification. They bear some resemblance to a variety of antiquated geopolitical entities, much like European palatinates, duchies, principalities, and some cities. They were essentially controlled by proprietary families. Much like city-states, they exerted political influence far into their hinterlands, but that influence was more likely to be over persons and goods than territory. In their territorial boundaries, their taxation policies, their military conduct, and their diplomacy, they also have characteristics consistent with territorial nation-states. We call them colonies, but exactly what this means has never been clear. Perhaps the best way to think about them is in light of what legal historians have identified as the layered and often composite nature of sovereignty in early modern empires. Whatever the American colonists may have claimed in their 1765 rejection of the stamp tax or their ultimate declaration of independence from Great Britain, the British Empire had always been a place of competing and overlapping powers and jurisdictions, and those powers and jurisdictions, whatever their legal source, were sustained through appropriation of lands and the income generated from those lands. It was precisely these facts that led to the creation of the Mason-Dixon line. The proprietary mode of government produced geopolitical conduct very much like that more commonly associated with sovereign territorial states, precisely because the burdens borne by proprietary government were, in large measure, equivalent to those borne by sovereign territorial states. Although the Mason-Dixon line originated from historical circumstances commonly associated with international borders, there was one quality associated with those borders the line acquired only very late in its history. That particular quality was, paradoxically, the one that most separates the line from colonial-era British-American boundaries. In the half-century following the Revolutionary War, the line was incorporated into a system of discipline and surveillance that distinguished between insiders and outsiders, between full members of the national community and human beings long denied membership in that community. Those insiders and outsiders did not carry the designations we most commonly associate with legally sanctioned membership in a national community, citizens and non-citizens, or aliens. Instead, they carried arcane designations that are, at least superficially, very much unlike the designations associated with rights-bearing citizens or citizens at the territorial limits of nation-states. The insiders and outsiders designated by policy surrounding the Mason-Dixon line were, respectively, free Americans and enslaved Americans of African descent. What dictated insider-outsider status thus had less to do with one's capacity to demonstrate legal affiliation with a given territorial entity than it did with one's capacity to demonstrate a very different kind of legal status, that of a free or enslaved person. For white Americans, this meant that the line remained, in effect, as it had always been. These Americans' associational status was more or less unchanged, whichever side they found themselves on. For Americans of African descent, the story was obviously completely different. One's legal status was entirely conditional. On the south side of the line, African Americans were either free or enslaved. On the north side of the line, where slavery was gradually abolished, a resident black American would be either a free black or a fugitive from slavery. Although African Americans legally crossed the line, they did so under the onus of a legal regime that looked very much like one we might associate with modern international borders. They were required to carry identity papers, and they bore the burden of demonstrating legal status before ordinary whites, as well as state and federal magistrates. Those lacking suitable documentation faced a species of deportation into a life of slavery. The fact that, as a demarcation of insider-outsider status, the line limited the movement only of one particular group, might suggest a geopolitical demarcation, very much unlike modern international boundaries. The latter, in theory at least, establish insider status equally for all naturalized citizens. Of course, the reality is very different. Whites on both sides of the 19th century line were much like citizens of wealthy, developed countries, able to travel unimpeded by the walls and fences and security personnel marking the territorial limits of nation-states. For the global poor, political refugees, and other victims of political instability and economic insecurity, in contrast, boundary crossing obviously means something very different. In the present-day United States, undocumented migrants live with ethnic and legal stigma, in addition to the fear of imprisonment and deportation. For Americans of African descent, life north of the line came with very similar hazards. These counterfactuals can obviously only go so far. Although the experience of African Americans across the line may have had similarities to the experience of modern migrants, the legal and political apparatus surrounding the movement of these groups were very different. While many migrants are denied citizenship, some wealthy industrialized states accord them basic human rights. The degree to which undocumented migrants actually enjoy such rights obviously varies widely. Similarly, some have argued that human rights have come into being primarily as a means of easing the international movement of cheap labor. Liberal governments, according to this reasoning, can justify denying migrant laborers citizenship because they accord them the purported right not to suffer torture, unjust imprisonment, enslavement, and assorted other cruelties. Alleged runaway slaves could claim no such rights. For a time, some northern states afforded African Americans a species of state citizenship. Northern personal liberty laws allowed accused fugitives from slavery to argue against claims on their persons in state courts. But no national or international legal order guaranteed them rights to anything like habeas corpus or freedom from cruel and unusual treatment. In arguing that the Mason-Dixon line bore hallmarks of borders between modern nation-states, my purpose is to uncover a long-overlooked chapter in early American history. The story of the Mason-Dixon line will also, my hope, reinforce what has been a far-reaching development in early American history writing. From a place once studied for what it made exceptional, what made it different from European progenitors, scholars have come to understand early America through the networks linking its peoples to the old world societies and states that sponsored its colonization. Understanding the history of the Mason-Dixon line less for what made it distinctly American and more for what made it reflective of larger, transcontinental, transoceanic processes that shaped the early modern and 19th century worlds reinforces just how important that boundary was, not only to the history of the United States, but also to the broader global history of state-making and political development. If the story of America's founding divide resonates with similar stories elsewhere, I will have achieved one of my core ambitions, reminding listeners that ours is not a history sui generis, but a history of processes and peoples, far transcending anything so fleeting as a line on the land. Part 1. Marchlands in Motion. Although Pennsylvania was founded nearly a half century after Maryland, the two colonies were very similar geopolitical entities. Both were founded by prominent Englishmen with dissenting religious views. Both were unmistakably commercial ventures. Both faced existential security threats from dissident factions within and from native and Euro-American nations without. And both were, according to the royal charters that authorized their creation, defined by strict lineal boundaries. Those boundaries were intended to function in much the way boundaries between nations function. They were to mark the jurisdictional limits of distinct, semi-sovereign governments. But a combination of limited cartographic knowledge and divergent political pressures meant that the intended function of these colonial boundaries would be almost entirely aspirational. Royal authorities deferred to colonial proprietors to resolve the ensuing jurisdictional disputes. As intercolonial diplomacy proceeded, violent rivalries with the Dutch and the dominant native powers of Maryland's far north, the Lenape and the Susquehannocks, would lead to lasting demographic change. Chapter 1. Lord Baltimore's Northern Problem. George Calvert, English founder of the Maryland colony and the first Lord Baltimore, was born in late 1579 or early 1580 in Yorkshire, a region dense with Catholic recusancy. The Catholic Calverts would bear witness to the stark confessional realities of the region's anti-Catholic persecution. Local authorities ordered the disbanding of the Catholic school George and his brother Christopher had attended, and the Calvert family was forced to employ a Protestant tutor to bring the boys around to the established creed. George's Catholic father, Leonard, capitulated to official pressure and entered the Church of England, but his mother, Alice, seems never to have done so. For the Calvert boys, the family's confessional divisions must have been deeply troubling, and surely had something to do with George's quest to found a Catholic refuge in America. Born into the church of their mother, but now seeing their father leave for England's church, the younger Calverts would have to make a difficult choice. For young George, clearly an ambitious child, the path would be clear. At age 12, he followed his father into the English church, and several years later, he matriculated at Trinity College, Oxford. Until 1624, Calvert would maintain his adherence to Anglican rites. After completing additional studies in the law at Lincoln's Inn, Calvert came under the tutelage of an exceptionally powerful patron, Sir Robert Cecil, the Earl of Salisbury. Although dwarfish in stature, Cecil was to become a titanic player in the royal court. Following his father, William, Queen Elizabeth's principal secretary, Robert entered the Queen's inner circle, initially serving as Secretary of State and eventually replacing his father as the Queen's closest advisor. By far, Robert Cecil's greatest achievement was managing the succession to the English throne of James Stuart, the King of Scotland and the Queen's second cousin. For his role in bringing James to power, Cecil was showered with lucrative offices and titles, and in 1608 was appointed Lord Treasurer, which was, along with Lord Chancellor and Lord Keeper of the Privy Seal, the highest office in English government. With so powerful a patron, George Calvert's ascent was swift. In 1606, shortly after the birth of Calvert's son, Cecil, named for his father's patron, the king appointed Calvert to the office of Clerk of the Crown and Assizes in the province of Connaught, County Clare, Ireland. In 1609, Cecil arranged for Calvert to take a seat in Parliament for the Cornish borough of Bossiney. He also arranged an appointment for Calvert as clerk in the king's signet office. The following year, Calvert received the ultimate promotion, becoming a clerk of the king's privy council. Proximity to power and power itself were of a piece in the early modern English court. Calvert was far from being a mere clerk. Short of being on the privy council itself, he could rise no further in the ranks of royal office holders. Calvert's prominence at court would lead to an assortment of important diplomatic missions, and in 1612, after Cecil's death, Calvert would begin work as an executor of the Earl's estate. The pinnacle of Calvert's time in the king's service came in 1619, when James I appointed him one of his secretaries of state. The former Catholic boy from North Yorkshire, who had been knighted in 1617, and who was now a member of the king's privy council, found himself with easy access to the monarch himself, by far the most valuable asset to which any Englishman could aspire, and a worthy tribute to Calvert's late patron, the Earl of Salisbury, a master courtier. Although Calvert had prospered in Cecil's service, his wealth was not what it would become after he joined the circle of the king's closest advisors. In a fitting display of Sir George's new stature, he purchased the Yorkshire estate Kiplin Hall, which would become the Calvert's English family seat until 1722, when it was sold by Calvert's great-great-grandson and future proprietor of Maryland, Charles Calvert, the fifth Lord of Baltimore. Although he served the king during the initial age of English overseas expansion, for most of his first decade in royal service, Calvert treated this burgeoning empire as did most other members of the king's court, another benefit of employment in the royal household. He purchased shares in several colonial ventures, including the East India Company and the private company that established the Virginia colony in 1607. But Calvert took no special interest in these novel enterprises. The great mystery in George Calvert's life is his return to the Catholic Church. It appears to have happened around the time he sold his seat on the Privy Council to Sir Albertus Morton for the substantial sum of £3,000. His patron hardly seems to have begrudged so loyal a servant's return to Rome. As a final emolument, the king made Calvert Lord of the Irish Barony of Baltimore. Exactly how the first Lord Baltimore's Catholicism figured in his overseas ambitions remains as opaque a matter as his return to the church. The only certainty is that when Calvert began pursuing his colonial plans, those plans showed a distinct sympathy for England's Catholic minority. Even before his Catholicism became public, Calvert entertained thoughts of an overseas Catholic refuge. The province of Avalon, a colony in Newfoundland, established on lands Calvert purchased in 1620 from a bankrupted former Oxford friend, Sir William Vaughan, would receive a small number of settlers prepared to brave the harsh conditions of America's far North Atlantic coast. In exchange, these colonists would face no formal restrictions on their confessional inclinations. The colony's charter, granted to Calvert in 1623, would reflect the general religious attitudes of the court of James Stuart. There would be no bold assertions of religious tolerance, but neither would there be vigorous enforcement of the supremacy of the English Church. A colony with Catholics was far from a Catholic colony. Another characteristic of the Avalon colony, while not exactly controversial, proved far more important, at least for Calvert's future. The colony was to be a feudal palatinate, a type of land tenure characterized by one authority as affording its lord a very close relation to the person of the sovereign. What this meant was not so much political proximity as manorial authority. The lord or earl palatine would effectively possess powers over his feudal grant undifferentiated from those of the king over his kingdom. He could create manorial estates or enfief smaller holdings. He could appoint and oversee magistrates. He could levy taxes. He could dictate ecclesiastical affairs. He could make and enforce law, in consultation with his subjects, and he was otherwise empowered to govern and defend his fiefdom. This palatinate model represented a departure from earlier colonial charters. As a means of encouraging private investment, these had been granted to limited liability joint stock companies controlled by a board of investors. That board would, in effect, be the highest court of appeal and would have substantial influence over lawmaking. With unitary ownership, governance of the Avalon colony would also be unitary. It would reside with the person of a vice-regal Sir George Calvert, Lord Baltimore. The unitary propriety of a palatinate served aims consistent with ancient practice, the rewarding of a favorite with hereditary title to some portion of the realm. But the Crown's decision to include a palatinate clause in Avalon's colonial charter had little to do with rewarding Calvert and much to do with colonial geopolitics. The palatinate originated as a means of maintaining control in regions far beyond the reach of ordinary institutions of government. England's palatinate counties, Chester, Lancaster, and the oldest of them, Durham, were all in the north of the country, far from the seat of monarchical authority. The Bishop of Durham, the ruler of that country palatinate, had much broader powers to assemble armies and organize military action than did other feudal lords, and this proved vital in mobilizing defenses against Scottish invaders. In exchange for policing English borders, the bishops of Durham could expect general immunity from royal writs and other proclamations. With no representation in Parliament, lawmaking was left to the bishops and their courts. Relations with the crown came not through the usual networks of royal patrons and parliamentarians, but through quasi-diplomatic agents. The Avalon colony was never to attract more than about 100 English and Irish settlers, most of whom endured horrific deprivation and sickness. Writing from Fairyland, his feeble colonial seat, Calvert appraised the crown of his colony's dire circumstances. His own house hath been a hospital all this winter. Of 100 persons, 50 sick at a time, myself being one, and 9 or 10 of them died. To prevent further loss of life, Calvert and his family abandoned Fairyland to search for a more hospitable Avalon, eventually making their way south to the Virginia colony. With the collapse of the Virginia Company in 1624, local officials now served at the pleasure of King Charles I, who had succeeded his father and Calvert's patron in March 1625. A more temperate colony, controlled by clients of the Stuarts, Calvert concluded, was the best available alternative to an unsustainable Calvert-owned colony in the frigid north. Although happy for such an esteemed courtier as Lord Baltimore to join their colony, Virginians were less happy about the arrival of a powerful and influential Catholic. Calvert might have allayed their concerns by swearing oaths of allegiance to the English king and to the king's supremacy over England's church. As a member of Parliament, the Protestant Calvert had done so, but now he refused. The Governing Council of Virginia, anxious about rising religious disorder, could hardly indulge such egregious dissent and began pressuring Calvert to leave the colony. Calvert returned to England, where he spent the final 2 years of his life planning a new Avalon, one that avoided both the climatic constraints of Newfoundland and the religious ones of the king's existing colonies. Because of his loyalty to the king's late father, Calvert remained a loyal favorite and somebody whom Charles I saw as a worthy agent of his realm's American expansion. With the help of friends on the Privy Council, Calvert petitioned the crown for a chartered colony south of the James River. The scheme ultimately failed, after former directors of the Virginia Company complained that it violated their claims to Virginia Company lands. It is a measure of how arcane and improvised the legal apparatus of English colony building was that such a claim had any validity at all. The Crown had, after all, revoked the Virginia Company's charter, but the former holders of that charter argued that royal control did nothing to alter their property rights. Like any feudal conveyance, the charter granted permanent title to portions of the king's realm. In revoking the charter, the only thing the king had done, according to this logic, was affirm his authority to govern his dominions. Investors still owned Virginia, at least as stipulated by the colony's founding documents, and a grant to Calvert on lands so close to the company's original settlements clearly violated this fundamental agreement. The idea that former shareholders would give over portions of their rightful claims to another colonizer was all the more alarming when that colonizer was a Catholic who had already refused to subscribe to Virginia's Protestantism. Rather than litigate the claims of Virginia Company investors, the Privy Council accepted the opposition argument and proposed a new location, this one north of Virginia. Here it seemed there was less danger of intruding on the former Virginia Company claims, but a northern location would also accomplish a pressing new strategic end. Thriving Dutch Atlantic trade, a byproduct of the Netherlands' long dominance of the Baltic trade and its more recent entry into the Asian spice trade, transformed the United Provinces into a commercial juggernaut. The influx of commercial wealth allowed the Dutch West India Company, a private corporate behemoth designed to exploit the mercantile and financial zeal of Dutch merchants, to wrest New World silver and land from the province's Iberian enemies. In the 20 years after its founding in 1621, the company took control of Curaçao, as well as several other Caribbean islands, and began laying claim to Portuguese Brazil. For the English court, the more immediate concern was Dutch colonization along North America's Atlantic coast. The Dutch colony at New Amsterdam had shown itself to be as avaricious and expansive as its English counterparts in Massachusetts and Virginia. From its beachhead on Manhattan Island, its traders established fur trading posts far up the Hudson River near present-day Albany, and south on the east banks of the Delaware River in the vicinity of present-day Camden, New Jersey. A northern location for Lord Baltimore's new colony could thus counter Dutch expansion into the lower Delaware Valley. George Calvert died on April 15, 1632, at age 52, 2 months before the charter for his new colony received its final royal seal. The charter would be granted to Calvert's eldest son, Cecil, the second Lord Baltimore, and it would look very much like that awarded George for an earlier Calvert family venture. Like Avalon, the colony of Maryland, named for the queen consort Henrietta Maria, was to be a palatinate. Cecil Calvert would have sweeping powers, not only over the government of his new colony, but also, much like the bishops of Durham, over its ecclesiastical affairs. In fact, he would have far more control, at least in theory, than the 17th century bishops of Durham had. After 1536, King Henry VIII had constrained the judicial autonomy of the Durham bishops, and royal magistrates would subsequently assume control of that palatinate's legal system. In Maryland, the second Lord Baltimore and his heirs would be empowered by judges by them delegated to award process, hold pleas, and determine in those courts and tribunals in all actions, suits, causes, and matters whatsoever. Whatever the precise political origins of the Maryland Palatinate, the political consequences of a chartered entity enjoying extensive constitutional autonomy were far-reaching. For Virginia's supporters, the fact that Cecil Calvert had such sweeping powers only made the Maryland colony more threatening. The first Lord Baltimore had already proven reluctant to disavow any papal allegiances, and now the second Lord Baltimore was being granted a minor kingdom in territory claimed by the directors of the former Virginia Company. Able to conduct his own diplomacy and warfare, Lord Baltimore could ally his colony with Catholic Spain, or perhaps even build direct ties to Rome. Even more troubling, there was no constitutional clarity whatsoever about the Palatinate's powers relative to other colonies. Should Virginia and Maryland come to dispute their respective boundaries, for example, the terms of the Palatinate suggested that Maryland would negotiate as a quasi-independent state, while Virginia, now a royal colony, would have to defer to royal authority. For the Virginians, this might have been a mere technicality had there been a different king. But Charles I's court, with its well-known Catholic sympathies, could not be trusted to insulate faraway Virginia from the machinations of English Catholics. In its efforts to appease Virginia Company partisans, the Privy Council and its lawyers employed a new method for parceling out the Crown's American domain. The Lords Baltimore and their heirs would have title to a clearly defined tract, or at least as clearly defined as 17th century cartographic knowledge afforded. Maryland would include the Delmarva Peninsula, excluding its southern tip, which remained in Virginia and was separated from the colony by a boundary line running from Watkins Point on the west due east to the Atlantic coast. The colony's northern boundary, and the one that would eventually be the point of contestation with William Penn and his heirs, would begin, "Unto that part of the Bay of Delaware, which lieth under the 40th degree of north latitude," and would follow a direct path to Maryland's western boundary, a north-south meridian line running between the 40th parallel and the first fountain of the River Potomac. The southern boundary would then track the Potomac's far bank to a certain place called Sinquack, situate near the mouth of the said river, where it disembogues into the aforesaid Bay of Chesapeake, and thence, by the shortest line, unto the aforesaid promontory of place called Watkins Point. In the history of American boundary making, the Maryland Charter was momentous. It represents the first time England attempted to confine a colony within lineal boundaries. In some ways, the cartographic progression of England's mainland colonies suggests growing sophistication. From the Virginia colony, an amorphous grant between two parallels of latitude, defined in space primarily by nature's dictates and the expansion of fortress-like outposts, England's colonies came to have lineal boundaries, made possible by improved cartographic knowledge. But progress would be the wrong frame through which to view Maryland's boundaries. Maryland was, at base, a feudal conveyance. It represented a monarch's efforts to reward a favorite while serving larger geopolitical aims. In this way, it was no different from the medieval Palatinates, or really any other feudal conveyance. Although the Palatinate carried no ongoing obligation to the monarch, no knightly service or socage, it was, like all other forms of feudal land tenure, a portion of the king's domains granted to a royal favorite as a reward for service to the court. That it was a bounded grant reflected the fact that this particular colony, however necessary a prize for the Calverts, and however useful as a bulwark against Dutch expansion, was created at a time of continued confessional strife. The second Lord Baltimore was an unlikely lord for his new Palatinate. Although he inherited a title, he never held government office, and his reputation at court was paltry compared to his father's. He was at best a shadowy factotum to the celebrated first Lord Baltimore. But perhaps Cecil's relative insignificance turned out to be beneficial. Lacking his father's association with James I, he would have been a much less alarming neighbor for Virginia. At the same time, without his father's influence at court, and without the former Secretary of State's experience in foreign affairs, Cecil would have to rely on very different resources if his family's new American venture were to avoid fatal political entanglements. A less devoted son or a less opportunistic subject might have abandoned the whole business altogether. An Irish baronage was modest by English baronial standards, but in conjunction with Cecil's English estate and his family's name, it gave him ample wealth for an aristocratic style of life. And yet, abandoning the new American colony was something Cecil seems never to have considered. 8 years into its founding, a total of around 500 English had come to Maryland. Fewer than 400 survived long enough to appear on the colony's tax rolls. St. Mary's City, Maryland's first official English settlement, consisted primarily of agricultural laborers, tenants, and small freeholders. Although this relative concentration of English colonists adhered to the authority of the second Lord Baltimore and his king, by the early 1640s, that authority was in decline. By the middle of the decade, the colony's government, such as it was, would collapse, and the colony would descend into chaos, raising the threat of a writ of quo warranto, dissolving Maryland's royal charter. Adding to Maryland's challenges were a few hundred colonists, a diverse and motley collection hailing mostly from Holland, Sweden, Finland, and England. They built fortifications along the Christiana River in the lower Delaware Valley under the auspices of an entity known as the Swedish West India Company. But in fact, these colonists were agents of Dutch commercial ambition. Although the Dutch West India Company had abandoned its colonizing efforts at the far southern reaches of New Netherlands, the Indian trade continued to attract Dutch merchants. With the endorsement of the Swedish crown and a group of Swedish investors, Peter Minuit, the German-born former director of the New Netherlands colony, established a new Swedish-sponsored settlement on the southwestern banks of the Delaware River. During the middle decades of the 17th century, this nominally Swedish colony would become the focus of a global conflict between native groups and European powers. That conflict would conclude with far-reaching geopolitical realignments. In place of a Dutch threat, Maryland confronted a very different kind of threat, this one from its own English countrymen. And far from the powerful fur traders they had been during the first few decades of Maryland's existence, the Susquehannocks would become refugees, driven from their home villages deep into Maryland, where they would be victimized by the fateful events known as Bacon's Rebellion. This tumultuous chapter in Maryland's history accompanied profound demographic change. While Chesapeake, Maryland looked more or less as it had 20 or 30 years earlier, still a place of small, isolated plantations, a critical change had begun occurring in the colony's workforce. From one dominated by English indentured servants, it was increasingly populated by enslaved laborers of African descent. Following the English Civil War, advisors to the restored Stuart monarch, King Charles II, began contemplating action against a very weak link in the Dutch West India Company's commercial empire. A declining fur trade had driven the company to redirect its activities from trade to settlement. In the contest for territorial expansion, the company proved no match for its English counterparts. English settlers had already begun occupying Dutch-claimed Long Island and portions of Connecticut. Puritan families from New Haven, meanwhile, took advantage of ever-shifting claims along the lower Delaware to settle there as well. Given its importance in the face of foreign settlement, Charles II's advisors reasoned that New Netherlands was ripe for English annexation. And in March 1664, the king granted his brother James, the Duke of York, a patent for a vast new American estate, incorporating New Netherlands. This included all territory west of the Connecticut River and east of the Delaware River, in addition to Dutch claims in the upper Hudson Valley, the English-claimed islands of Long Island, Nantucket, and Martha's Vineyard. To seize control of his new colony, the Duke of York appointed Richard Nichols, a distinguished former cavalry commander and close advisor. Nichols was to lead a small invasion fleet carrying several hundred English troops, some of whom had been promised American estates in exchange for military service. These costly preparations proved unnecessary. By the end of August 1664, after some shrewd diplomacy by Governor John Winthrop Jr. of Connecticut, Peter Stuyvesant, Director General of the New Netherlands Colony, surrendered his charge to England, and the colony of New York came into being. In October, a member of Nichols's invading party, Sir Robert Carr, accompanied by his son, Captain John Carr, sailed two ships up the Delaware River to the Dutch Fort Casimir, not far from the old Swedish colony on the Christiana. The Carrs demanded the surrender of the remains of the fort and the nearby Dutch village of New Amstel, to be rechristened Newcastle by the English. Carr, a ruthless colonizer with little regard for legal formality and much regard for himself, proved indifferent to the fact that these Dutch settlements were situated on the Delaware's western shore and thus were beyond the limits of the Duke's grant. When the region's inhabitants resisted, Carr and his men killed and injured several of them and seized all of New Amstel, including a number of enslaved Africans, a sawmill, a brewery, and livestock. The assault on a peaceful settlement infuriated Governor Nichols, who had been commanded by the Duke of York to accommodate Dutch settlers, so long as they swore allegiance to their new English lord. Were it not for Carr, in fact, the English seizure of New Netherlands would have involved precisely what the Duke of York and his brother the King had hoped for, a peaceful transition in colonial lordship. Nichols traveled to New Amstel to reassure settlers that, despite Carr's outrages, they would be left in peace, on condition that they demonstrate allegiance to their new English lord. But Nichols did little to compensate the former Dutch colonists for Carr's plunder, and, in a pattern that would define royal policy toward Maryland, never accounted for the fact that the attack took place outside the Duke's formally recognized claims, never mind that they were actually within the competing claims of a fellow Englishman. Things could hardly get worse for the second Lord Baltimore. For decades, he had little success countering Dutch claims to the northeastern corner of his colony, but at least his battle was consistent with the aims of his charter, contending with threats from a foreign power. There could only be political gain in an English lord's advances at Dutch expense, but now those advances would come at the expense of the king's brother. Whatever Lord Baltimore's charter may have indicated, there was little guarantee that the crown would choose to overrule the Duke of York's agents and restore Maryland's claims to the Newcastle settlements. By the late 1660s, the eastern coast of North America, from the Carolinas to Maine, was at least nominally part of the dominions of the King of England, and all of this vast territory had been parceled out among various proprietors and private companies. Any further grants near coastal North America would thus intrude on existing grants, or would involve interstitial lands on the margins of those grants. The absence of any systematic accounting for the territorial limits of existing grants made it difficult for the lords of trade and plantations, the Privy Council, the committee charged with administering colonial affairs, to identify with any real clarity the limits of those interstitial lands. In an attempt to inform the lords about the spatial extent of England's proliferating American colonies, William Bathwaite, the Lord's secretary, assembled a collection of colonial maps into what is now known as the Bathwaite Atlas. The collection is a treasure, the definitive cartographic accounting of England's overseas conquests, but still numbers only a few dozen maps in total, many fragmentary and inaccurate. Augustine Herman, a Czech religious refugee who settled in New Netherlands and became a prosperous fur trader and colonial official, was responsible for one of the most important of the Atlas's maps, at least from the vantage of Maryland's proprietor. Herman came to know Lord Baltimore's younger brother Philip in 1659, when the mapmaker and another Dutch official traveled to Maryland to negotiate an agreement over competing claims to the lower Delaware Valley. The negotiations achieved little, but they did make clear to Herman, Philip Calvert, and the second Lord Baltimore that Whatever the intent of the Privy Council clerks and lawyers who drafted Maryland's charter, the actual boundaries of the colony remained abstractions, enshrined in an obscure legal document. In an effort to strengthen his claims to the Lower Delaware and the Delmarva Peninsula, Lord Baltimore commissioned Herman to prepare a definitive map of Maryland, including contiguous lands and waterways. In exchange for the map, Lord Baltimore granted Herman the right to several thousand acres along the Opequimimi River, whose name Herman would change to the Bohemia River in recognition of his Central European origins, on the far northeastern shore of the Chesapeake. Herman, with his long-standing connection to New Netherlands, saw the location in terms of its commercial potential. His Maryland manor would be near an easy portage between the nearby Elk River and the Christiana River, or Minquas Kill, as it was known to the Dutch. The map Herman created, acquired by Bathwaite several years before William Penn petitioned the crown for his American colony, established an unprecedented level of cartographic clarity about the coastal contours of the eastern shore of Maryland, the Chesapeake Bay, and the lower Delaware Valley. A dotted line just along the map's solid right-hand border, the map has a western orientation, depicts the 40th parallel of latitude, Maryland's northern limit, as understood by the colony's proprietor. This feature of Herman's map bore heavily on Herman's own commercial fortunes, since it proved that Cecil County, where Herman's Bohemia Manor was located, was in fact in Maryland. Herman's map, a cartographical masterpiece by any standard, was not entirely accurate in its placement of Maryland's northern boundary. The actual 40th parallel crosses the Schuylkill River south of the mouth of Wissahickon Creek, just south and west of present-day Germantown. Herman depicted the parallel a number of miles to the north, intersecting the Delaware River above present-day Rancocas Creek, called by Herman the Rimocas, near modern Burlington, New Jersey. Herman was closer to the mark with the western limits of Maryland's northern boundary. He located the line at Fort Susquehanna, the Susquehannock settlement on the west bank of the river, just north of the mouth of the Conestoga River, called by Herman the Onestoga River, perhaps owing to a printer's misreading of Herman's original, and not far from the actual 40th parallel. In addition to its confusing placement of Maryland's northern boundary, Herman's map entirely ignored the festering tangle over rightful control of former New Sweden. In Herman's depiction, the colony was firmly part of Maryland. The one concession Herman made to the contested nature of Maryland's northern border was his depiction of Cecil County. Instead of extending the county north to Maryland's northern boundary, Herman left its northern limit unmarked. This may have been Herman's way of acknowledging the claims of his former Dutch employer, Peter Stuyvesant, or it may have been an acknowledgement of the claims of the native nations on which his own business interests depended. None of this can be known for certain. But what is certain is that the printed version of Herman's map demonstrates that even the most accurate contemporary maps afforded royal officials only marginally improved grasp of the precise territorial limits of England's mainland colonies. It had been a generation since a tiny Dutch outpost known as Swanendael had been obliterated by its Lenape neighbors. Settlers had, since the destruction of the colony, avoided the area near remote Cape Henlopen at the mouth of the Delaware Bay. It was too vulnerable to storms, Dutch and Spanish pirates, and the Lenape, who retained control of the region. Most settlement was higher up the Delaware River, between present-day Newcastle and Philadelphia, and almost entirely on the Delaware's western bank. Other than the occasional Dutch sentry stationed at the remains of the original Swanendael fort, and, after 1658, a few Dutch traders, the colony had been completely abandoned. But in the early 1660s, Swanendael, which the Dutch called Hoerekil and the English Hoerekil, the origins of the name are unknown, but its literal translation from the Dutch is Whore's Creek, and which, by decree of William Penn, eventually became Lewis, Delaware, would receive a new and very hopeful band of European settlers. Peter Cornelissen Plockhoy, a Dutch religious radical, spent the 1650s gathering financial support for a new heavenly kingdom in America. Well situated to take advantage of trade and whaling in the Delaware Bay, but far enough from the corrupting influences of the various mongrel Protestants residing in the region, Plockhoy hoped that Hoerekil, the name being no deterrent to his pious followers, could avoid the fate of Swanendael. seeking to encourage American settlement and perhaps deploy Protestant zealots to counter Lord Baltimore's claims to the Delaware, Amsterdam city officials had embraced Plaquoy's scheme, and in July 1663, a tiny advance guard of 41 colonists arrived off Cape Henlopen. But, unfortunately, a little over a year after the Dutch returned to Hoorkill, Sir Robert Carr embarked on his expedition of conquest and plunder along the South River, as the Dutch called the Delaware. Hoorkill did not escape the Englishman's rampage. Carr seized property, terrorized colonists, and is alleged to have sold some of them into slavery. Plaquoy himself vanishes from the record around this time, presumably victimized by disease or intercolonial violence. The failure of Plaquoy's colony should have been a great gift for Lord Baltimore. An enemy outpost on his colony's far eastern edge was gone. Cape Henlopen was now free for full incorporation into the Maryland colony. In addition to giving Lord Baltimore control of his colony's easternmost coast, the Cape had immense strategic value. Lying at the mouth of the Delaware Bay, it afforded control over maritime traffic through the bay. Lord Baltimore never saw these benefits. Having long understood Hoorkill to lie well within his territorial jurisdiction, in 1662, Lord Baltimore ordered the area incorporated into Maryland as part of the new Worcester County. Although briefly deterred by the Duke of York's conquests, by 1669, he was again taking action to prevent future foreign annexations, ordering his son Charles, who was now Maryland's governor, to use all means possible to procure that some persons be seated upon the seaboard side on the eastern shore and on Delaware Bay within the degree 40 northerly latitude, and particularly the Hoorkill. Maryland's proprietor further instructed his son to establish a new county to be called Durham and divided into two manors of 6,000 acres each, encompassing the western shore of the Delaware Bay, from Hoorkill to the 40th parallel of latitude. The whole was to be protected by a new militia force headquartered in Worcester County. Should any inhabitants of these newly incorporated areas oppose Lord Baltimore's rightful rule, Charles was to maintain his lordship's right by force, if need be. What was happening in Maryland's far north could hardly have escaped any remotely aware observer. Lord Baltimore was preparing for the first actual border war in Maryland's long history of border wars. There had been fighting in the colony's northern borderlands since its founding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.